Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Okay, Luke 11, verses 1 through 11. I'm going to read this together, and I'm going to help us see a tremendous opportunity that the Lord Jesus has given our church to respond to a message like this. All right, Luke 11, let's have it up on the screen. Verse 5, what did I say? Okay, that wasn't the truth. Luke 5, 1 through 11. And I want to thank the PowerPoint for getting Luke 11 so fast. That was the wrong scripture. All right. When you have it, say amen. Read with power and conviction. Read with authority. On three. One, two, three. Ready? Read. Which was Simon's. He asked him to put a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Verse 8, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." This is quite an extraordinary story. And I want you to see that when you read that whole story, something happened when Jesus simply got in Peter's boat. My question to you is, my question for myself is, what will be your response when Jesus gets in your boat? How will you respond? How will you act? Now, let's just set it up. Let me tell you a little bit about where we are in the gospel presentation of Luke. Let me give you a little context of Peter and some of the disciples and a little bit where Jesus is, and then I'll show you how he got in the boat and they start participating with his work. He started helping with them work, and then he changed their work. They start participating with his work. He started helping them with their work. They didn't ask him to. And then he really changed all their work altogether. I'm going to show you how that happened. Now, this is an extraordinary thing. You would think for Jesus to get in someone's boat that he has to know the person to just walk up and get in somebody's boat. Otherwise, he'd be extremely rude. And the first time that Peter and the Lord actually met, it was at his house. The Bible says in Mark that, in John that John was explaining that the Christ would come, and he must decrease, the Christ must increase. He baptized Jesus, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world." His disciples that were standing with him heard about it, and they followed Jesus home from that baptism. One of them was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He went and got him and said, "Come on, we're going to Jesus' house." This is their first meeting. I mean, how would you like that, your first interaction with the Lord? We're going to his house. Somebody said, Jesus had a house? Yes, he had a house. They get to Jesus' house, but that's not the only interaction. You'll find out later in the story that Peter has a family, and Jesus visits his family and heals his mother-in-law before this story takes place. Jesus himself, the Bible says, is hanging out by the Lake of Gennesaret, and he gathers a big crowd, and they're pressing in on him to hear the word of God. From the moment that Jesus got to this planet after he was baptized, after he defeated the devil in the wilderness, the Bible says he's kept preaching the kingdom. He kept preaching, repent. He had something from God that he was saying, and there was the words that bring eternal life. And he was casting out devils. He was healing the sick. And every time someone had an interaction with Jesus, they were trying to convince him to stay with them. They were trying to either go with him, or they wanted something from him. But the scripture says before this verse we read happened that Jesus had drawn away to a desolate place. So we see that every time someone met Jesus up until this point, they had a reaction. Now, Peter is interesting. We're not going to hear much from him yet. He's been at Jesus' house. I would think the scripture will say, man, I was at Jesus' house. It was good. I couldn't believe I was that close. They said he could be the Messiah, and he started teaching us, and he's starting to break my heart. But he was in the house, but had nothing to say. Have you ever just been in the house and around the worship, around the word, and around the things of God, but your reaction is nothing to say? You look at some people crying and you still have nothing to say. You look at some people coming to the altar and you still have nothing to say. You look at some people rejoicing because they're getting healed, but you still have nothing to say. Peter was in that point where he's just silent. Now, if Jesus comes to your house, your mother-in-law's house, and heals her, you would think the scripture might record and Peter said, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. What a mighty God, mighty God, mighty God. But nothing. And Jesus is doing his work. And he needs some help doing his work. And he sees some boats and he sees some men working. And he recognizes, I know Peter. He's been to my house. I've been to his house. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me getting in this boat. The first thing I want you to help you recognize is, do you have that type of disposition where Jesus could assume he could just walk up to your stuff and get in? Imagine it like this. You got all this crowd is out, and somebody just gets in your car and start telling you what to do. Even if you know him, you say, man, you don't just get in my car like that. You just change. Jesus is doing his work, and he's so focused on ministering to this crowd, and he figures out he needs a little help, and he engages Peter with an opportunity to help him. The Bible says he gets into Peter's boat, and he says, you know, he don't know where it's going. He gets in Peter's boat and says, hey, push off a little bit. He don't know where it's going, and then he sits down and starts teaching the people. And Peter, because he did not resist this activity, remember, he hadn't said anything yet. Remember, the whole point is this: what will you do when Jesus gets in your boat? Remember that Jesus is at work, doing work, and Peter is now joining in his work with silence. So you see that Peter is still around all this stuff that Jesus is doing, but he's in the boat with silence, but he's having to hear a message. See, I believe that people should come to church and be around the word of God, whether you've settled the issue about who God is in your life yet or not, whether you know for sure he's the Christ, whether you think he's the Christ, whether you just think he's good, the miracle worker, just stay in church. Stay around the word of God. Stay around the place where they're speaking about the word of God. And by the way, when Jesus is doing his work, he's not doing it in the synagogue. The scripture clearly said in the verses preceding this that he had just come from the synagogue. He had just come from Judea. A synagogue could not hold a multitude of people, but the revival was not in the temple. It was not in the church. It was outside of the church in a place where Jesus was hanging out. See, Jesus was bringing revival to his community and to his neighborhood. Capernaum was just about a mile away off of the lake. It's only 15 miles this way, 7 miles that way. If you're looking around the lake, you can see what's going on. Jesus was making the gospel known exactly where he lived, exactly where he worked, exactly where he hung out. He was showing you what fishing for men really looks like. It doesn't begin and just going. There's nothing wrong with going to Mexico or Honduras or going to Africa or going to Iceland. There's nothing wrong with that. We're supposed to go on to all the world, but you gotta reach your city and your community first. Jesus is showing you, I'm in Capernaum. That's where Peter's house was. That's where Jesus' house was. He was at work when it was most inconvenient. You know, the thing about reaching your neighbors that we don't want to talk about is, then you got to be talking to them all the time. I reached one of my neighbors one time, and they've come here and given their testimony before, and they had problems. And every night after since I had ministered to them, they were at my house every night, knocking on the door, brought me their marital problems, anything, it was brought to my house. A lot of times we don't want to minister where we live or where we work because it brings us into a level of accountability. Jesus is having Peter. Peter can't hide it. You would think that Peter, if you have been to Jesus' house, and Jesus has been to your house, how come the scripture doesn't read, and then Peter said, I will be with Jesus all of the time for the rest of all time? You know, no, Jesus is doing a revival meeting, and Peter is washing his neck. Like, I ain't got nothing to do with that. I'm glad for him. I took the healing. I think he might be special, but that's what they do. I'm working. You see, we can't join Jesus in his work because we're so busy doing our work. But what if Jesus just get in your boat? He didn't ask him. He just stepped into his life and said, could you just push out a little bit? Push out a little bit. And then he sat down. You know, you can let somebody come over. Can I borrow some sugar? That's easy. Can I borrow your lawnmower? Usually you say, yeah, but when am I going to get it back? I don't think Jesus was leaving room for them kind of, you know, interactions. Like, how long you need it, Lord? Oh, I can imagine Peter, he done sat down. Didn't he see me washing the nets? Like, we're done working. He can't be in the boat without me. But remember, when Jesus is in your boat and you start helping Jesus with your work, just with your silence, just to your availability, he just asking little stuff. You know what Peter had to do? He had to hear that gospel message real clear. He had to hear Jesus speak with authority. He had to hear him speak about the kingdom. He had to hear the compassion and care he had for their lives. And you know it impacted Peter, because remember when Jesus was dead and they were walking on the road to Emmaus and they didn't really recognize that it was Jesus that was walking with them until he disappeared and he was speaking to them, and they said when he left, that had to be Jesus. That's how you know, because did not our hearts burn within? See, when God speaks the word to you over and over and over again, there is nothing that can satisfy the longing of your desperate spirit like a word from God. And you're wondering if you're hearing from him. I'm telling you, you're hearing from him. Conviction is being stirred up every time you're under the anointed word of God. You're being seized and sensitized to be able to respond to God. And it becomes like a fire shut up in your bones. I bet something was building up on the inside of Peter that he really couldn't contain. I bet you Peter was being silent, but he's going to have to speak in a minute. But before he could speak, the Bible says, when Jesus was done speaking, when Jesus was done with the crowd, when Jesus was done doing all that God had assigned him to do, he turns and begins to speak to Peter. Peter probably thought Jesus' mission was the people, but Jesus' mission included him, the individual person. Yes. See, discipleship for you might start off as a big group activity, but typically it always distills down to a one-on-one relationship, helping someone else follow Jesus. He was about to help Peter do what he appeared to have the inability to do up until this point, follow profoundly, clearly, and absolutely. I'm not saying that he didn't have an inclination up until this point. I'm not saying that he didn't have an availability up until this point. I'm telling you, it just wasn't profoundly clear. Everything is up for grabs. And then we see in verse 4 what happens. Verse 4. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep, let down your nets for a catch. He didn't ask Simon, Simon, you think you could do me a favor? And maybe, I know we've been ministering all day, but I feel like some fishing relaxation. Let's just, if it's okay with you, could we just, like, let's just all go fishing a little bit. No, that's not what he's saying. He said, Peter, I'm done with the work you were helping me with when I got in your boat. You helped me do my work. It is your turn for me to help you. Get in the boat, go out to the deep, let down your net for a catch. This is a prophetic utterance. He didn't say, let's go out there. See, fishing is going out there. This is fishing. Because I don't think Jesus is fishing. Jesus is catching. That's a difference. The last time I went fishing, it was a four-hour trip. I would not embarrass myself and show you the one fish I caught. And when you're fishing, every time you throw it out there, you're hoping. You're hoping. That's the joy of fishing. This is my moment. Nothing. Jesus did not tell him, go out there and just throw it out there a few more times. He says, when you throw your net out, you will have a catch. Here's Peter's response, and it shouldn't surprise us. Simon answered. By the way, this is the first time he's going to speak. The first thing he says, Master. I love this because it shows that Peter has had some upgrades over the last few days. He's not got him at teacher or rabbi and possibly this is to say. He said, hey, look, let me upgrade you. You at least the greatest leader I know. Right now, Peter is the master of his vessel. Peter is the master, but yet he is surrendering to the master. And before we give him too much credit, Peter still's got to be himself. You know he got that yes-no spirit, right? The yes-no spirit sound like this. Peter, rise, kill, and eat. No, Lord. No on kill and eat, but you still the boss. Peter got that little back and forth thing. Jesus said, I'm gonna be crucified, handed over. He said, no, I'll never let that happen. He got a thing on him. Yes, you're the Christ, but no, I'll not let you die. He said, listen, you're the master, but we have toiled all night and took in nothing. He got to always be telling Jesus what's going on, really. Jesus, now you the Lord of heaven and earth, but you don't know nothing about fishing. I always think you know something, Lord. I got something for you. Now you didn't talk all day, but this is my business right here. You in my boat, Lord. You in my boat, Lord. Now I didn't call you master. I didn't down myself as far as I can go, but we didn't work all night. And don't you think if we have toiled all night and not caught one fish, did we know something? Like Jesus, by the way, you don't fish in the day. You fish at night. Like, you don't even know those basics, Lord. We would have caught something that would put something out there to catch. You see, this is the disposition and attitude that holds us all up from seeing results from God, is that when God's word comes, we start outsmarting him, especially when it's in our area of expertise. I already know how to be a mama. I already know how to be a daddy. I already know how to be a boss. I'll be a worker. I already know. And when Jesus gets too personal in your work, we start trying to back him up. See, we can help Jesus because it feels like, let me tell you why we can help Jesus. I'm going to give you the real secret why you can help Jesus. Because you don't have to do very much but sit there and listen. Jesus worked, Peter, what did Peter do? Let me prove how much Jesus don't need us and didn't need Peter. Let me just prove it for a minute. Before this moment, Jesus doesn't have a staff. He's been having the multitudes, healing sick. He was just teaching at a church. They didn't like his message, and they took him to a hill and said, "We're going to throw you off this hill, kill you." And he passed right through them. Jesus didn't need them to assemble the crowd. He didn't need them to dismiss the crowd. He just gave them something. Why don't you know, sometimes when Jesus gets in our boat, he gives us the smallest thing we could do just to partner with him. He does not need us. You really think he needed Peter's boat? He can walk on water. He could have just stood out there and said, "Hold on, y'all." And everybody would be like, "Oh, Lord, I love you." Start walking on water, the whole crowd would go crazy. But he didn't do that. What happens when God asks to get in your life and start telling you what you should do at your job? "Hey, I want you to go talk to the receptionist again about me. I want you to go to the neighbor who's been turning down your cookies and all your Bible study activity, turning down, and so now you've shut them out of your life for the last 2 years because they turned down your invitations. And yeah, I want you to go knock back on those doors. I'm preaching to somebody besides myself in here because I got some people I've been ignoring." And Jesus said, "Would you just listen to me and knock on a few doors?" So maybe I'm preaching to myself. Maybe you don't want to deal with your neighbor situation. And he begins, when he's in our boat, he begins to start telling us how to do our job more excellently. Peter surrenders. He said, "You know what? I know you don't know how it goes. And I don't want to press the issue anymore because I already surrendered. You know, you're the boss." So verse 6 says it this way. He says, go back down. He said, "But at your word, I'll let down the nets." We lose it right here. This is where we start outsmarting God. You in church right now getting convictions. What's happening to you right now is you thinking about all the people that the Lord wants you to talk. That's what's happening right now. Right now, right now. You're just getting visions. Uncle Joe, I got this guy. I suppose. And everything in you feels like this is a word for me. And you got this thing, whether you're going to listen to that word. Or this is going to be another occasion where you told him he was the master. You told him he was Lord. You told him he was boss. But you're not going to do one thing, James Lowe. You're not going to do one thing you're convicted to do when you're in my presence. You're not going to do it. Peter resists this temptation. And he said, "At your word." The specific, individual, special word, the rhema you gave me, I'm going to let down these nets, even though deep down, I don't believe it's anything down there for us to catch. I don't believe they're going to entertain my invitation again. I don't believe that it is worth my time to reach out another time. But yet, I'm just going to do it because your word says do it. He lets down the nets, and then he said, when he had done this, by the way, it's a guarantee. From the moment those nets went in the water, it was a guarantee. I'm going to say this again. From the moment Jesus said, "This is why we're going out here. We're not going out there to fish. We're going out to catch what I already ordained to be in the net." He said, when he enclosed a large number of fish. See, I know that when you think in a large number of people, you're just thinking about supersizing an already large meal. Been supersizing my whole life. So you can't really get the volume of what he's saying. And after we read verse 7, I think I'm going to help you understand how big a catch this was. Verse 7 says, Verse 6 says, "A large group of fish, and the nets were breaking." What that means is, that they didn't say the nets broke. It's that it was so heavy, it's still dragging on the bottom. Because see, the drag net hits the bottom. When you're catching fish with this kind of net, you throw it out, it hit the bottom. This load is so big, it never came off the bottom. If it dragged on the bottom too long, so they got it up to just enough to see that there's fish going. And then what they did, they said, then they signaled to their partners in the other boats to come help them. And they came and they filled the boats until the point that they were sinking. I want you to get this earthly picture so you can get the spiritual one. They got the boats And they start, and think about the net is on the side, and they just throwing fish in that boat. Now they're at the point where the water is going to come in, and they're going to sink. And they filled up multiple boats, and the net is still dragging. Now, when you're working on the word that God gave you, you might not actually recognize right away what's going on. See, when you caught up in God answering prayer, where if Kevin York would have proceeded and not heeded the word, we could be doing his funeral. But when you heed the word, you get life. But what I'm telling you we pray for is his life is just multiplied. It's abundant life now. So see, when you listen to the word, your life gets multiplied. Your work gets easier. Now watch what happened. But when Peter saw it, he fell down before Jesus saying, "Depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord." And when, verse 9, and he and all that were with him were astonished at the catch the fish was taking. Here's what I want you to get. This was so amazing that they knew a God moment happened. Now you would think you've seen him heal the sick. You've seen him preaching. Why was this important? Because there's something about when we see God do stuff for other people, it sometimes it don't register for us. But then sometimes when God gets your address and he come right down your street, I'm talking about right down your street, park in front of your house and knock on your front door, this is what's happening to Peter. Peter and the other fishermen are saying, "We've been doing this our whole life. And we got generation after generation of fishermen in our lives. And in the history of us hearing stories about fishing and us going out and doing this for a living, we ain't never imagined anything like this in an instant. And especially from, this can't be natural. This is supernatural." You can tell that there was something uncertain in their heart that God is beginning to clarify because they simply acted on his word. You've been wondering if I am who I say I am, and I'm going to keep on proving it to you, and it's going to be so undeniable. Hey, God bless. This blessing was also a test, if you ask me. Because Peter could have got excited. Here's a couple reactions he could have had. Woo! We rich! Hit the jackpot, Jesus! Genie in the bottle! Genie in the bottle! Genie in the boat! They could have been saying, "Jesus!" They just could have been drunk on all of the good things. They could have been spending that money before they got it. Cashing in. This is a catch that can set them up for life. This is like where you buy more boats out of this, where you franchise, you start going to other lakes. This is it. This is the mother of all catches. This when you go around high-fiving. I knew we should have helped Jesus. That's why we help people. We help people. When he got in my boat, I knew this is our day. This is our day. Could have had that reaction. The reaction he had bypassed his natural mind. He was doing stuff like, no. Good things happen to good people. No. This good things happen to people who work and toil, and I already worked and toiled. Why is this good thing happening to me? The only thing I did is help him. Oh no, it's really him. Okay. He's in the Jesus is sitting in the boat. Peter, okay. I said you was the master, but I wasn't acting like it. Okay, hold on. Just get out of my boat. This is what he said. get out my boat. I can't be looking at you. Because when you think about your darkness and you get a revelation of his light and his life, the only thing you can do is surrender or run, but you got to do something. And he saw the light of God just like Isaiah saw it. And when he was in the presence of God, he fell at his feet like a dead man. Say, I'm a man of unclean lips. I live upon a people with unclean lips. Peter began to say, I want to confess. I'm guilty, but God didn't ask him any questions. See, there's a presence of God. There's a miracle of God that can happen in the human heart when you no longer care what your friends think. He was the master of the boat. He was the leader of the boat. But he starts saying, you know, I'm a sinner. I'm messed up, jacked up, tangled up. I got anger problems. Lord. Now, I don't believe Peter at this moment had full revelation, but I believe he had enough in him to say, change is here, change is here. But he wasn't presuming that Jesus should be in a relationship with him. You know what my problem is that I think I'm good. I think I'm pretty fantastic. I think Jesus is making a good choice when he chooses me. I think I'm one of the best people I know. See, there's some being self-absorbed. We are self-absorbed humans. We have read our own press. We actually think we're pretty fantastic. I'm the best mom. I'm the best dad. I'm the best worker. I don't have to respond like all of those little multitudes following Jesus. I've been in personal invitations and all that. He's helped me out. But I'm somebody. It's good for him to be with me. And all of a sudden, that changes. When you recognize you don't even belong on the team to be invited to work with Jesus because he got in your boat is the highest privilege in the universe. Can you imagine when he was washing those nets? And he was washing them. And he had a choice to make. Because a lot of us don't have time to obey Jesus. We're so busy making a living, we don't have time to live for him. What living are you trying to make, Peter? But Peter got a revelation that God can make up in a moment for whatever you sacrifice for him. So is our unwillingness to obey the mandate to go out into the world, make disciples? Is it because there's something else that we need to be doing to make a living? Well, Jesus is at work in your work when he's in your boat. But the ultimate thing he did was he changed this man. Jesus will get in your boat and change you. And his verse, the 10th verse, is this way. And so also James and John and sons of Zebedee were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be catching men. Did he say you'll be fishing for men? What did he say you're going to be? Catching them. And what was the way he caught them? With a what? And that dragnet is to pull on the bottom and trap all of the fish. And when you use the dragnet, you usually get a whole bunch of other stuff you may not be looking for. And you also get a variety of fish instead of, who's a fisherman here? Raise your hand. When you're fishing for tarp, what do you use? Carp, tarp, whatever you call that. Who? Snowball. What about catfish? Worm. So wait a minute. So you use different bait to catch different fish. The dragnet ain't about bait and fishing. This is about catching. This is me throwing out that gospel net, saying, get on in here. You ain't got no choice. See, the problem is not the gospel. The problem is that the gospel is not being preached. Because I'm going over to knock on my neighbor's door, and I got nothing to say but hi. They're lost. They're busted. They're disgusted. You see them Sunday after Sunday. They don't go to church. They're not thinking about church. They're not thinking about God. So what do you know? Their life is jacked up to the max, and they need relief. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is that relief. The dragnet will drag them right in to do the work that you can't do and I can't do. He said, from now on, you'll catch men. You'll catch them. The scripture means to catch them alive. Catch them and make use of them. Catch them and clean them and disciple them so that they could do the same thing. And finally, it says, and when they had brought their boats to land, I mean, all this was happening in the boat. I always denote, man, this catch is so big, it took them a minute to get back. They left everything and followed him. This denotes an abandonment. Do you want to be stuck at the blessing God gave you? Your little house, your car, your job. You want to be stuck there? That's your blessing. Take it. Live with it. But that's not the life of abundance he has for you. Isn't it funny that they could have gotten caught up in what just happened? I would at least want to sit around the fire and just cook up some of the fish and talk about it, you know, change up the story. But Jesus said it, but then I said, Jesus, you know what we really need to do? Throw out five more nets. And then that's when we got all the, that's when we just started doing. We started making the gospel about us. You know how many people I led to the Lord? And I just started Benihana-ing and I just stirring it up. And the Lord was like, yeah, do your thing, James. No. It's him. They left everything and followed him. Peter made, okay, last two statements. Stand to your feet for these last two statements. The ministry team, you can come down. When the rich young ruler was faced with this scenario, and Jesus told him, leave everything, all your possessions. Come follow me. The Bible says he went away sad because he had great possessions. It's not a given when Jesus asks you when he's in your boat to leave everything. It's not a given. But the question still remains, what will you do when Jesus is in your boat? Peter eventually said in Luke 18, verse 28, he said, Lord, we have left everything. The context, the scripture above, which says, any man having left father, brother, sister, mother, lands, cattle, for my sake and the gospel shall receive in the next life a hundredfold of these things. He's not telling you he wants you to have nothing. He doesn't want anything to have you above him. This is not a vow of poverty. Peter was taking care of his family. How you know? Because Jesus said, he don't take care of your family, you're worse than the infidel. They was the fish, guys. He was hooked up. But he wasn't dominated by his blessings, his bling, his opportunity to be the man. He was caught up in the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ. Bethel World Outreach Church, Jesus told me something. He's not going to change the station for me or you. The specific individual assignment of this church is to reach the city, touch the world. Kind of difficult to get as far as we need to go in the world when you don't get towards your neighbor. It's time for a life change. Jesus is in your boat. Now, are you calling him master? Are you letting Jesus work on you and change you? I'm begging him to change me. Because I'm tired of knocking on doors. But I think I've been doing it in my own strength. Now I want to pray and get a word from God to throw out the net. We're going to have an opportunity a couple of weeks as a church to throw out the net and bring people to our outreach. You can throw out the net tonight. You can invite somebody over to dinner at your house. You can just throw out the net. Say simple stuff like, can I just tell you God loves you? That's good. That's what you got? That's what you got. I'm not calling you down to the altar for this message because this message is for our entire church and I'm going to pray for all of us right now. This is for us. You can raise your hand if you want, but I'm going to raise my hand because I'm just telling the Lord I'm surrendering freshly. It's up to you how you want to respond, but this is me saying, God, whatever is about to be prayed, you count me in on this. I'm in. Lord, see these hands? See this church? We're saying what Peter said. Master, at your word, we'll extend an invitation.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.